Welcome to Buried Secrets, a podcast about the paranormal, the occult, and weird and forgotten history. I'm Chris. So I'm back this time talking once again about, you guessed it, haunted Fordham University. This is the maybe fifth episode I've done as part of this series, though you can listen to it in any order that you want to. And I've been trying to keep this series not short, but not too long. But I just have so much content at this point, and I've kind of done so much research and either confirming, debunking, etc., that, you know, it just keeps stretching on. So last time I said that this episode, I wanted to talk about my own paranormal experiences in Finlay Hall, which was the old medical school building on Fordham's campus. It had a morgue in the basement, and it's now a dorm, and it's a very creepy building. I do not like this building. I had a very bad experience there, and I had some weird paranormal experiences there. So I was going to talk about that in addition to the history of the building, some of the common ghost stories, etc. However, I realized that that would have been way too long of an episode, so I have split this into two sections. So in this episode, I'll talk about the history of the building, Finlay Hall. I'll talk about Fordham's doomed medical school. I'll talk about some of the most common ghost stories and urban legends associated with the building. I'll share some of the research that I did when trying to verify or debunk some of the claims and urban legends tied to what different parts of the building were used for, and kind of the connection that those uses have to the current hauntings. And I'll also talk about Fordham's infamous tunnels, which go between different buildings on campus and are very creepy. However, I'm not going to get to my own personal experiences in Finlay Hall. That's going to have to be next episode. So next episode, I'll talk about the experiences that I had there. I'll talk about some of my theories behind some of my experiences, right? Like, I'll look at trying to connect the potentially paranormal phenomena that I witnessed to the history of the building, the area around the building, etc., and just see if I can make any connections or at least come up with some theories as to what I may have been experiencing there in that building. So that deep dive is going to be next week, but this week we'll just talk about the building itself and its urban legends and ghost stories. Also, I just want to apologize in advance if the audio quality in this episode isn't quite up to snuff, isn't quite as good as the usual audio quality. I've been having a lot of issues the last couple episodes with recording in our apartment because the radiators are so loud. So I'm in a different room than usual, and the radiator is much quieter in this room, but it is facing a busy street. So you may hear some cars driving by. I'm sorry. I'll try to cut out anything loud. And you also might hear some floorboards creaking because this is a creaky part of the apartment. So I'm sorry. I'm doing my best. I hope it's not too bad. So let's get into it. If you're just jumping into the series with this episode, Fordham University is a Jesuit school, so a Catholic school in New York City. Its main campus is in the Bronx. It also has a campus in Manhattan, and it is primarily a university, though the Bronx campus also has a prep school attached to it. And there's also a law school, a graduate school, etc. So it's not just undergrad. However, Fordham does not have a medical school, not anymore at least. It did have a short-lived, ill-fated medical school, and I think that Thomas J. Shelley, author of Fordham, A History of the Jesuit University of New York, 1841 to 2003, said it best when he described the medical school at Fordham thusly. Fordham Medical School was like a corpse that had been buried in quicksand and periodically threatened to make an unwelcome appearance by bubbling to the surface. So basically, there was a medical school, it sucked, it was attempted to be revived many times, that didn't work. Fordham still does not have a medical school. So the Fordham Medical School operated from 1905 to 1921. So it was only open for 16 years, very short-lived, like I said. Initially, when the medical school opened, it operated out of Collins Hall, which is a building that I'll talk about a couple episodes from now that has plenty of hauntings associated with it. Then it was moved to the Science Building, now called Thebaud Hall, which was a building that was built in 1886 and has some vague mentions of hauntings attached to it, but I haven't been able to find anything super concrete about Thebaud Hall. I remember when I was a student, there were a lot of creepy stories associated with Thebaud, and there's this big chimney coming out of the building, and I remember people talked about it being supposedly a crematorium, etc. I haven't really been able to corroborate that. Don't know if it's true or not. But anyway, it was moved to Thebaud Hall, and in 1911, a new medical school building was built on Fordham's campus, and the medical school moved there in 1913. And this new medical school building is what is now known as Finlay Hall. Though in the past, it was also known as Old Chem, the Old Chemistry Building, and New Hall after the medical school closed. So one notable thing about the new medical school building was that it was built right on the edge of campus by what's now known as the Bathgate entrance. So I mentioned this a couple episodes ago, but Fordham is a closed campus. You can't go on without speaking to the security guards at a couple entrances around the fence. And, you know, you have to show your ID and say why you're coming to campus, etc. So there's just a few entrances, and the Bathgate entrance is one of them. And supposedly the reason why the medical school building was built right next to the entrance is that it was to facilitate the discreet delivery of cadavers. So basically, like, if cadavers were being delivered to the medical school, they wouldn't have to drive through all of campus with the cadavers. They could just drop them off there. Not 100% sure if that's true, though it does seem plausible. And I'll get to more about cadavers later. So another notable thing about Fordham's medical school, which I think is interesting for those of us who are into the paranormal, is that Carl Jung did a lecture series at the Fordham Medical School in 1912. So that would have been before the medical school was moved into Finlay. I'm not sure where this talk was held, but he did do some lectures there. And I believe the lecture series was part of a conference called the International Extension Course in Medical and Nervous Diseases, which was held from September 9th through 28th, 1912. And Jung's Fordham lecture series was notable because it was where he publicly broke with Freud, who he used to agree with more than he did by then, etc. So there is a little Carl Jung connection to all of this for all of you Jung heads out there. So the medical school, after it was established, grew pretty quickly. It started with 6 students in 1905. And by 1916, it had 256 students and 111 faculty members, which is a pretty good faculty to student ratio. It's kind of wild. And medical students were getting experience at 10 different hospitals in the area, including Fordham Hospital, which I'll talk about in a little bit. So things were not fated to go well for Fordham's medical school. I don't 100% understand why, but for whatever reason, the medical school just doesn't seem like it was a priority. So the first dean of the medical school was made dean, but he didn't want to leave his private practice. So then he was replaced the next year, already off to an inauspicious start. So then the medical school always had money problems because it wasn't really a priority. And it lost its Class A status from the American Medical Association in 1911, only 6 years after the school opened. And the school was downgraded to a B class by the AMA because when they inspected, they felt that Fordham fell short in clinical training and in full-time faculty members, and Fordham declined to fix the issue. So that's why they got the downgrade, and getting the B class status basically meant that Fordham had a third-rate medical school. So basically it was just seen as a crappy school and acknowledged as such by the AMA. So after that downgrade, the next medical school dean resigned, and then the dean after that apparently tried to save the school, but he just couldn't get financial support from the administration, so he resigned in 1917. A new dean started after that, but by 1919, it was clear that Fordham just couldn't afford to make the changes that the AMA had said they had needed, and in that case, it kind of wasn't worth having just a crappy medical school, so the school shuttered in 1921. Apparently, when the school closed, it had a budget deficit of $342,000, which in today's dollars was like $5.2 million. Also, just a side note, I mentioned a Fordham hospital. So there was once a hospital called Fordham Hospital. It was a public hospital that opened in 1892, but in 1907, just after the Fordham Medical School opened, it moved to a 4-acre location northwest of the intersection of Southern Boulevard and Crotona Avenue, right next to Fordham's campus, on an area that today is part of Fordham's campus, though at the time it, you know, wasn't operated by Fordham or anything. While the Fordham Medical School was open, though, med students there would intern at the hospital, and for at least a bit in the 19-teens, the hospital president was also the dean of Fordham Medical School, so there were some connections between the school and the hospital. But in 1976, New York City Health and Hospitals decided to close the hospital. The community protested, there were sit-ins, and even the borough president and the community board were opposed, because obviously having a hospital is really important to a community, and it was, you know, a public hospital. However, the city closed the hospital anyway and tore down the building, and Fordham University bought the 4 acres that Fordham Hospital had been on in 1978, and now that is the campus parking lot. So let's just put a pin in that, but I do think that there's some significance in kind of this idea of like a failed medical school and a hospital that was closed to be replaced by something as pointless as a parking lot. There's just something there when, you know, as we're thinking about urban legends and the paranormal, etc., on Fordham's campus, it's important to think like what bad or negative things may have happened, what like bad vibes may be associated with the campus, etc. So just worth keeping that in mind, though of course it wasn't the university who decided to close the hospital. However, there's just something a little weird to me about that. And just this idea of like not prioritizing the med school, you know, which would get medical care for the community, etc. Anyway, once the medical school closed, the med school building became the chemistry building. And I found an interesting article from May 25th, 1980 in the RAM, which is the Fordham Bronx campus's newspaper, student newspaper. And it talks about the renovation of Old Chem, or the chemistry building, to make it into a dorm. So basically, this is a problem that occurred throughout Fordham's history, and I talked about it in the Hughes Hall episode, but they needed more housing on campus. So they decided they would renovate the old chemistry building. That renovation would be done by September of 1982. And interestingly, the building had sat empty, apparently, from 1974 to 1980, or I guess 82, when the dorm opened. So there's just something a little bit weird about having that building sit empty for years. And it does harken back to some of the stuff I was talking about with Hughes Hall a couple episodes ago, thinking about how the hall had been abandoned, and it seems like maybe students had partied there, and there were some urban legends that had grown up around that hall as it had just sat basically empty. So interesting that another building on campus, kind of around that same time, a little bit later, had a similar fallow period, I guess you could call it. So this article had a paragraph that was really funny to me that I just want to read, because to me, Finlay Hall is not nice or pleasant as a dorm building. And I'll talk about that later, but to read from this article. The building will be renovated in a loft design, making it, quote, one of the most attractive buildings in the New York area. Although the structure of the building will remain, its interior will be demolished. The plans call for an additional floor on top of the building and will provide some 55,000 square feet of living space for approximately 320 to 350 students. The rooms will be 3-person duplex apartments, each with its own balcony and private bathroom. No kitchen facilities are planned. So just to pause on this, this is hilarious to me. So when it says its own balcony, this isn't a balcony looking out to the outside or like outside the building. Instead, there's a lofted area in most of the rooms of Finlay Hall. So basically, like, you walk in, there is a ground floor area in the dorm room where two students usually live. And then there's a spiral staircase and a little loft, and usually the third student who lived in the room would live up there. So to say that they each have their own balcony kind of implies some picturesque idea of having a balcony to the outside. And it's like, no, there's a part of the room that looks down on the other room, which, as I discovered from living there, is actually very creepy because, at least in the room I lived in, you couldn't see if my roommate was home, if she was upstairs in her loft, but she could see everything down on the ground floor where my other roommate and I lived. So when you're thinking about paranormal stuff, when you're thinking about people feeling uneasy about these lofted areas in the dorm rooms, which I'll talk some more about later, just think about that, right? Like, you are living somewhere where you can't even tell if your roommate is there or not. And maybe some people maybe arrange their furniture differently and you could see if the person was up there, but that was not the case in the room that I lived in. It was very creepy, even just from that standpoint, before you even dip into the paranormal stories about the dorm. So there's that underlying anxiety if you're someone who lives in that building, you know. There's this idea that there's always someone watching you from above. And like, hopefully that person's just your roommate and hopefully you get along, but you can't really shake that idea that you are being watched from above. So, important thing to keep in mind. So anyway, the building was called the Old Chemistry Building or Old Chem, then it was called New Hall. Then in 1990, it was renamed Finlay Hall, which is what it was called when I lived there, and that's what it's still called. In my opinion, I know I've basically said this already, Finlay Hall is the creepiest building on all of Fordham's campus. It was the place where I experienced the most unsettling paranormal things that I experienced on campus. So let's talk about other people's ghost stories and experiences and urban legends about Finlay Hall. So first, let's talk about cadavers. The biggest ghost story, urban legend about Finlay Hall, of course, has to do with cadavers. It is said that cadavers were kept in the basement of Finlay Hall to be stored for dissection. And for what it's worth, I actually believe that this urban legend is true. So the laundry room of Finlay Hall was in the basement, which, to be honest, is one of the most unpleasant places I've been in New York City, maybe in my life. It felt terrible down there. And I remember you didn't really have cell service down there. It felt really cramped and dark and just unpleasant, as basements often do. And unbelievably, to me at least, there were actually a few rooms down in the basement where students lived. It was only male students because Fordham has a policy, I assume it's still in place, where women couldn't live on the first floor or the basement of any building. So some guys had to live there, who I feel very bad for. And I definitely knew people who lived down there, and it was unpleasant. So there's some dorm rooms down there. There's also a lounge and the laundry room and some sort of mysterious off-limits rooms that I remember. But anyway, I remember walking down the hallway in the basement and seeing at least one, but I think there may have been several, tall, narrow doors on the hallway, you know, in the hallway, that were always locked. And I remember thinking, ah, yes, this must be where the cadavers are, because they seem like the perfect height and width for a stack of pull-out shelves to hold bodies. Now, I could be completely wrong, but that's just my impression of being down there and thinking like, okay, cool, that's where they put the cadavers. Great. Figured that one out. So anyway, the cadavers were supposedly kept in the basement, and cadaver dissections were said to have happened upstairs. And it is said that in individual dorm rooms, back when it was a medical school, the students would stand upstairs where the lofted areas are now, and they would watch cadaver dissections happen down below. I have some problems with that characterization of how that worked, which I will get into later, but that's at least what the common urban legend says. So I'm going to read a little bit from the Fordham Library website, which has a section about paranormal happenings on campus. Finlay, before becoming a dorm, was the location of Fordham's medical school. In the lofted rooms, students could observe dissections of cadavers, and the basement served as a holding place for the lifeless bodies. More than once, students have woken up in the middle of the night, feeling as though someone is grabbing at their throat, making it difficult for them to breathe, or feel a tugging on their toe as if they were a cadaver being tagged. They also sometimes see what looks like students peering down on them from the loft. So I'm not trying to say that these potential paranormal experiences are not real or that people haven't experienced them. This doesn't match up with the experiences that I had in Finlay Hall, but that doesn't mean they're not true experiences that generations of students have had, whatever. But again, like I said, whether or not you're experiencing something related to medical students, like the ghosts of medical students watching you, as someone who is living in a dorm room in Finlay Hall on that ground floor of the room, you always have in mind this question of like, is my roommate upstairs? Is someone watching me, etc.? So there is that automatic anxiety there. And there's also this idea that it's like, yeah, maybe there's medical students up there. Maybe it's the ghosts of students past who lived up in the loft and perhaps looked down. And the reason why I'm saying this is that I don't believe that in the medical school, the classrooms were set up the way the dorm rooms are set up now. I've been trying for years to substantiate or debunk the claim that the rooms were set up as operating theaters. Years. Literally since I lived in Finlay in the late 2000s, I've been trying to puzzle this one out. I've gone through the Fordham Library's photo archives maybe 5 or 6 times, all the way through looking for any photographic evidence of this setup, and maybe just no one took a picture of it. And since the library website claims that the medical school was set up that way, they may be right. But if you've been listening for a while, you're probably familiar with how urban legends form and get echoed and repeated. And the Finlay paranormal stories and urban legends are just so delightful and chilling and morbid. And it's just so neat and tidy to be like, yes, see this room you're in? Real students stood up in that loft and looked down at the cadavers, and that's what these ghosts are, etc. Like, that feels good. It feels like something from a movie or a book. It's a story. It all makes sense. That being said, as soon as I moved into Finlay Hall, I looked around and I was like, well, this doesn't really make sense because the lofted areas are really tiny. Like, the room has a high ceiling, but it's of course a lot lower in the loft area. And the loft is small, but the rest of the room is big. So if everyone's just looking down at a doctor and maybe a couple doctors, instructors, whatever, dissecting a cadaver, the doctor doesn't need that much space, but you do need a lot of space to house or to hold all these students who are looking down over this rail from this tiny little loft into this large room that's empty except for someone dissecting a cadaver. Like, I was just like, this doesn't make sense because only the students in the very front would be able to see what was going on in the dissection. Otherwise, you would just be looking at the backs of the students in front of you because it's not like a sloped area, etc. So from day one, I was like, I have questions about this story. And just in general, I've talked about this before, anytime an urban legend or a haunting is sort of too clean, it's too neat and tidy, it's too perfectly mapped on to a history of a place, then you really have to ask yourself, is the story affected by the history of the place? Like maybe it's being influenced by the history of a building, or maybe this story, this ghost story, is accurate, but the history of the building that people are assuming from this ghost story isn't quite right. So here's what I was able to glean about the setup of the cadaver dissection areas, like the operating theater, etc., from looking at medical school photos from Fordham's archives, as well as many other sources. So first, I want to read this bit from the Fordham website. This is from the page about student housing and what Finlay's like to live in, etc. It then became a residence hall, adding lofted apartments where classrooms and offices had once been, and a fourth floor with a copper-clad roof and facade. The five-sided eastern face of the building at one time housed an operating theater. Finlay Hall's facade features beautiful examples of cut stone ornamentation and lower floors terrazzo from the era of its design and construction. So this operating theater thing was new to me. I don't know how I hadn't heard of that before or not, but I just, while I was doing the research for this episode, came across that bit on the Fordham website. I don't think that page said that back when I was a student. I think it had been updated with more information. And of course, immediately I'm like, well, if there was an operating theater, then that's kind of describing the thing that people keep saying the rooms are like, because they're basically saying the rooms are like a operating theater. But of course, it would make sense for demonstrations of dissections, etc., to happen in an operating theater where everyone can see it, or in a small classroom setting where everyone's gathered around something and watching, versus this idea of being up on this loft way far away where you can't really see, etc. So anyway, I don't know how I hadn't heard of the operating theater thing before, but I went to the Google Maps satellite view, and sure enough, Finlay is a rectangular building with this extremely obvious bit jutting out. And it is, you know, a five-sided chunk just jutting out from the side of the building. I don't know why I never wondered about that, but maybe that's just because I was thinking about it from the inside rather than from a bird's eye view. And I didn't live in the part of Finlay that had been the operating theater. I was right next to that part, so I could see that from my window, and I always noticed there was a part coming out of the side of the building, but I just never thought to wonder why it was there. It just didn't seem that weird to me. And when going through the Fordham photo archives, I did find a picture of an operating theater with either a cadaver dissection or an operation going on. And I hadn't read about this operating theater in Finlay before, like I said. So for years, I had seen this picture and thought, well, that can't be Finlay Hall, because the windows behind the assembled students in the sort of bleachers or whatever, the windows just don't look like the Finlay Hall windows to me. But maybe the windows in that section of Finlay Hall are just different. And to be honest, now that I think of it, I can't imagine that there was another room on campus set up to house a different operating amphitheater. I think it just had to have been that operating amphitheater part of Finlay Hall. I just never really spent time in that part of the building. And the picture I'm thinking of is captioned Amphitheater at Fordham Medical School, and it really does look like a purpose-built room, so it has to be in Finlay Hall. Also, I found a picture of a bunch of students in a class with telescopes and textbooks and stuff, and I think that picture was definitely taken in Finlay Hall because the windows are correct, and you can see a spiral staircase on the far right of the picture. That being said, there isn't a loft arrangement to the room. The floor goes from wall to wall, and there's basically just a small cutout for just the staircase. So maybe later on they converted this room by cutting out part of the floor to make a loft or subdividing it into a few different rooms. So that definitely aligns with the idea that the Fordham housing website put forth, where they were like, okay, there's just the operating theater and then the rest was classrooms and offices. That seems both the most logical explanation for how the building was set up, and also it just makes the most sense based on what the building looks like now. However, this does suggest an inaccuracy with the story that students stood in lofts in what are now the dorm rooms and looked down at cadaver dissections below. Like I said, I would imagine that that would have happened in the amphitheater, where, as the website says, the other rooms were regular classrooms and offices. And, like, I do think it's very possible that maybe some cadaver dissections were held in a classroom building with people gathered around looking down at the body. I don't think that's inaccurate or, like, out of the realm of possibility. I don't know that much about early 20th century medical school methodologies, so if you know more than me, please correct me, but that just logically seems possible. And I do think that I found a picture of what looked like a cadaver dissection in a classroom building, or in a classroom, regular classroom, not the amphitheater. So I would imagine that would happen. So I'm not trying to say that if a student wakes up in the night and feels these figures looming over them and feels like maybe their toes being tagged, like, you know, a body might be, a cadaver might be, you know, I'm not even saying that that wouldn't have maybe happened in the room where the student's living, but unless you're living in the part of Finlay Hall that had the amphitheater, I just have trouble believing that there would be people looking down from the loft, which I think, you know, the lofts in those dorm rooms seem like something that were added or hugely modified when it was converted to be a dorm in the 80s. And I don't need to spend a huge amount of time on this, but I do think it's worth mentioning that many people, not Fordham people, just people in general, have stories of being awoken in the night or waking in the night and seeing figures standing over them, whether it's shadow figures or kind of ghostly doctor type figures or figures that seem potentially like aliens, etc. That's like a pretty common thing. And there's a lot of stories about people having sort of screen memories where, you know, later on they realize that they were having potentially some sort of encounter with an alien, but in their memory, they're seeing a doctor or doctors operating on them. And, you know, I'm barely scraping the surface of that. If you want to hear more of those sorts of stories, I really recommend checking out the podcast Strange Familiars. He does tons and tons of research and tons of interviews with people. And he, the host, Timothy Renner, himself had experiences sort of along those lines. And it's like really fascinating and really creepy. And I'm not super into aliens, except in the ways that they intersect with the rest of the paranormal and like paranormal phenomena in general. But he posits, and I think I agree, that all of that is connected. So like ghosts and aliens and the fae and et cetera are all kind of connected in a way. So I'm not trying to say that people are having experiences with aliens and screen memories, et cetera, in Finlay Hall. I don't have any evidence to suggest that. And I think it's a little bit of a stretch. However, I couldn't just breeze by this without mentioning that this does fit into a trope of paranormal experiences that people have, and that there's a ton of stuff you can learn about that sort of experience. So if you're interested in that, check out Strange Familiars, and that'll lead you down a really nice rabbit hole of all sorts of strangeness. So to get back to Finlay Hall, I talked a little bit about Finlay's basement, and I want to pause and talk a little bit about the Fordham tunnels, one of which connects to the basement of Finlay Hall. So when I was a student, I remember lots of stories about this mysterious network of tunnels that went around campus to some of the older buildings. Some people said they were used for transporting cadavers, and there are websites online that still claim this, while others say that the Jesuits used the tunnels to get between buildings during particularly cold weather. After doing some research, I don't really think I believe these stories. I guess it's possible that they were used in that way at some point, but I don't think that those purposes are why those tunnels were built. And the cadaver thing in general, I just don't understand why they would move the cadavers from the medical school building to another building, unless somehow the Fordham Hospital building was connected to Finlay Hall through a tunnel. That seems plausible to me, but I have not heard anything about that being the case. And again, Fordham Hospital wasn't officially run by Fordham. So it seems a little weird that the buildings would be connected, but not totally out of the realm of possibility, I guess. But after doing some research, it seems like the tunnels were used for steam and electricity, and they were dug sometime in the 1880s. I know this is not as exciting of an explanation, but it's the most plausible explanation that I have found. So I read about this in the book, Fordham, A History of the Jesuit University of New York, 1841 to 2003, which I mentioned before, and I confirmed it in a story on the Fordham website, which had some interesting information about the electrification of Fordham. So I wanted to read from that article. Nearby, Lower Manhattan was lighting up with a new kind of illumination powered by electricity. But electrical lines ended below 59th Street, and it would be more than a decade before they reached the Bronx, where the tenebrous 19th century night was lit only by the feeble glow of oil lamps, gas lamps, and candles. So the college's Jesuits made their own power instead, with the installation of a generating plant on the site, then named St. John's College, They powered light bulbs across the campus and quite possibly inaugurated the electric age in their rural region, according to research by two Fordham professors. It could be that this is the first electrification in the Bronx. We don't know that anyone else beat us to it, said Alan Gilbert, PhD, professor of anthropology and co-author of an article on the project. Its appeal was evident at Fordham. Candles and fuel-burning lamps provided only a dim flickering light and emitted heat, smoke, haze, or particulates, which made for hard studying during the long nights of fall and winter. Most simply did without and spent the evening in shadows. So then the article goes on to talk about Thibaud Hall and its history. So to read some more. It had a generating plant in the basement where Freeman installed a Weston dynamo bought from the United States Electric Lighting Company for $3,154. It was powered by a steam boiler, which heated campus buildings via newly dug tunnels that were also used to extend electric wires across campus. By October 1889, electric lights were installed in most outdoor areas and in all the principal campus buildings, where they usually hung from the ceiling. They were turned on for about 6 hours a day, ending at 9:15 p.m. It was seen as wondrous. The whole campus was lit up, and you could see your way from building to building, said Wines. He said one student quipped, "It's even easier to study Greek with electric light." The college generated its own power until connecting to the city's expanding power grid in 1908. So, to me, this story explains several things. The purpose of the tunnels around Fordham, and it also explains, I think, the weird chimney in Thibaud Hall, which I think I mentioned people used to claim that it was a crematorium, that there was like a crematorium attached to Thibaud Hall, which didn't ever make sense to me. My guess is that it had to do with the power generating plant in the basement of the building, because I assume there would be some sort of exhaust coming out from that. So this is, again, a lesson in looking for the actual history of things rather than kind of making up or believing urban legends. Obviously, a lot of things are paranormal, but there's also a lot of things with a very realistic or reasonable explanation behind them. So when I was a student, I was told that the tunnels connected the older buildings on campus, including Queens Court, which I did a couple episodes about, Alpha House, which I had mentioned, it was the old guardhouse, and there is a haunting associated with that, Hughes Hall, and then I also think Dealey Hall, which I talked about last time, and Finlay. Since Fordham was connected to the power grid in 1908, it seems strange that the electric tunnels would be built for newer buildings, like buildings built after 1908, including Finlay Hall, but my guess would be that the tunnels were still being used for steam, like steam heating, and so that's probably why they were connected, though I can't say for sure. I do remember that when I was a student, there were weird patterns of melted snow on campus. So for example, I could see this large, long patch of melted snow from my window in Queens Court, looking down into the courtyard when it snowed, and the theory was that the stretches of melted snow were there because the ground was warmer in the tunnels, so that melted the snow from below. Especially if those were steam tunnels, like for the radiators, it does seem possible to me that that's the case. So if you're a current student and you're curious about these tunnels, that's potentially one way to see where they might go. Though, of course, I do know that students sometimes do venture down into the tunnels. I would never do that because I'm very claustrophobic. And it just seems like it would be unpleasant and damp and moldy down there. But I definitely remember stories about people going down into them. They're off limits, but I do remember even when I was in Finlay, I remember once I was wandering around the basement, poking around, because as much as I hated the basement, I was also very curious about it. And I remember once this door that was always locked, because I usually checked it, this door was open. And there was this big room that looked like a storage room. And then on the far side of the room, there was a doorway to a smaller room. And I can't remember if I could see the tunnels right beyond that or not, but I got a really strong sense that that's the entrance to the tunnel. Could be completely wrong, but that was a room that I believe was on the, it would have been the northwest corner of the basement in Finlay Hall. That's at least what I'm remembering. It was more than 10 years ago. Who can say for sure? But at any rate, I think it's almost impossible to not feel a little bit creeped out by tunnels and feel like there's something sinister about tunnels. So again, there's a tunnel feeding into Finlay's basement. I'm sure that adds to the atmosphere of creepiness there. So I did find some other Finlay ghost stories in the RAM, and I found this one story that was written October 25th, 2017, by Julia Boren. So to read a bit from that. Before Finlay became known for its cool lofts and spiral staircases, it was home to Fordham's medical school. Up in the lofts, students could observe dissections of cadavers, and the basement was home to these lifeless bodies. One student, Mike Casal, Fordham College at Rose Hill, 20, had a great uncle who allegedly died in the building. "Keep your eye out for a man named Jack Galvin," he said. Just for the record, I have not been able to corroborate the death of Jack Galvin. Like, I searched in the RAM for Jack Galvin and John Galvin, etc., and I couldn't find it. Doesn't mean it didn't happen, just had some trouble finding it. Students have reported waking up in the middle of the night feeling as though someone were grabbing at their throat, or they feel tugging on their toes. Erin Flynn, Fordham College at Rose Hill, 2020, had her own scary encounter. "I felt a hand gently resting on my shoulder twice while I was sitting at my desk. I was freaked out because it happened so close to my bed." Very interesting to me, and you know I love any kind of ghost story that's not too flashy and is associated with someone who's willing to go on the record with their name, etc. Definitely seems like a plausible thing and just seems right to me. Also, I just have to share this because it's delightful, but my favorite part of this article is that it closes with this funny warning, which is, "With all this knowledge, please use your discretion, folks. Try not to disrupt any ghosts. Let us all hope that if Fordham does have ghosts, they are friendly." I love a silly closing for an article that there's always this sense of having to sort of insert some doubt or kind of be like, it's kind of a joke. I just wrote a whole article about the paranormal and even have people who were willing to go on the record about their paranormal stuff. But, you know, if there's even ghosts, ha ha ha. I don't know. I just find that amusing and always enjoy a closer to an article like that. So I've got a couple more Finlay ghost stories. There's one famous story that claims that a security guard was taking a break in the basement of Finlay, where there's a lounge, and suddenly all of the doors slammed shut by themselves and the chairs started banging themselves against the walls. The story goes that he ran out of there and he quit on the spot. Some people say that this happened in another building on campus, Keating Hall, but my guess is that it was Finlay because that basement's just awful. And, you know, there are a few ghost stories associated with Keating Hall, but the atmosphere isn't as oppressive and gloomy. And I've spent plenty of time in the basement of Keating Hall. And, you know, part of The Exorcist was even filmed in the basement of Keating Hall, I believe in the language lab where I used to spend time doing language lab stuff for Spanish class. So I've spent time in that basement and I didn't really find it that creepy, whereas the basement of Finlay Hall was truly terrifying. So it's just my opinion. I think it happened in Finlay. I found one more story, which is a commenter on the website College Confidential told this story about their Finlay experience, which I thought was interesting. "I lived on the first floor and a friend lived in the basement. Actually, I was going to write this to essentially say, I went to Fordham, lived in various buildings, heard the stories, it's all talk. I think my friend in the basement did sleep with the light on occasionally. As I'm typing this, I now do remember this one time. My roommate was with me in our room on the first floor, we were on our laptops, it was evening time, and we heard running slash stomping right above us. The weird thing was that we were friends with the people right above us and knew they had gone away for the weekend. We called them and asked if anyone was in their room, and they verified no. Needless to say, we were a little scared and slept with a lamp on." So I love this story because it, to me, feels so real. I'm not saying like, oh, this random anonymous person told a ghost story, so it must be real. But I mean more like, so often I feel like people are like, I don't really believe in ghosts. Or like, no, nothing ever happened to me. And then they're like, well, there's one time where this thing happened. And it was weird, but maybe it was nothing. I don't know. And I think the reason why I like this kind of thing so much is because like this person's obviously a skeptic, but then like as he's writing this skeptical thing, he's like, well, you know, there was this one time and there was no explanation for it. And yeah, we were like pretty creeped out. And there's this like moment of maybe some assumptions being challenged, or maybe like the door being opened a little bit in this person's mind to the possibility of something paranormal potentially occurring. So I just really enjoy that. I wanted to close on that. And, you know, Finlay Hall, from the stories I've read today, it isn't as like credibly haunted, I think, from an objective standpoint, as somewhere like Queen's Court, where there's just like so many stories and a lot of people going on the record, etc. And of course, Finlay Hall, so many of the urban legends are tied in to the building's history and are not quite accurate to the history of like what different parts of the building were actually used for. So you could say they were sort of just invented, but that's what I would say if I hadn't lived there and felt how terrible it was to be in that building. And if I hadn't had some weird experiences of my own. And I think I mentioned this last time, but I did get very sick when I was living there as well. It was when swine flu hit colleges in the United States. So everyone was very sick. It was an unpleasant time to be living anywhere. And I'm sure that colored my perception of Finlay Hall, but I don't think it's just that. So next time I'll talk about those experiences that I had. I will also talk about some of the research that I've done since then to kind of try to give a narrative to some of the stuff I experienced, some of which I think you could potentially debunk very easily, and that I might be inclined to debunk if they didn't happen in tandem with so many other weird things in that building. But I did do some research, not just with an eye to like debunking, but also with an eye to saying, okay, if this was a paranormal thing, it doesn't fit in with the other stories I've heard about this building. So what could have caused it? Like, what in the history of the building or the history of the area might this be tied to? Is this some sort of residual thing or place memory, etc.? So I'm excited to talk about that. I'm gonna get into some weird stuff about this strange experimental college that used to be affiliated with Fordham, and with some primal scream stuff that used to happen on campus back in the day. And just like, I'm excited to share with you some of the weird places my brain has gone to try to make sense of the experiences that I had in Finlay Hall. So in the meantime, you can check out the show notes with all the sources for this episode at buriedsecretspodcast.com. If you went to Fordham and have weird Fordham stories, please email me at buriedsecretspodcast@gmail.com. I would love to hear people's stories. If you have friends who had weird things happen to them, please tell them to email me. I really want more stories. And for whatever reason, a lot of the people I know just didn't have weird things happen to them, but I know a lot of people have. So please send me your stories. You can follow me on Instagram at buriedsecretspodcast. If you liked this podcast, please tell your friends about it. Please rate and review wherever you listen to podcasts. And thanks so much for listening.